Now, you know that torque can cause a body to rotate. So, the next concept you need to grasp is how we can relate the torque on a body to the angular acceleration that is caused by this torque about the axis of rotation. And since torque is the equivalent of force in linear motion, we can make use of Newton's second law to draw an analogy wherein what we do is we replace the net force with net torque, mass with I, or the moment of inertia, and alpha with acceleration A. So you can say that this is Newton's second law adapted for rotation, quite the way we describe this as Newton's second law of motion for linear acceleration. Again, if you're interested in the derivation of this equation, you can find it in the description below. But for now, let's focus on understanding how to apply this equation by working through an example. And what we have here is a uniform disk that has a mass m of 2.5 kilograms and radius r here is 20 centimeters and it is mounted on a fixed horizontal axle. What we also have is a block of mass m equal to 1.2 kilogram that hangs from a cord that is considered massless and is wrapped around the rim of the disk. And what you have to find is the acceleration of the falling block, the angular acceleration of the disk, and the tension in the cord. Also, it is given that the cord does not slip and there is no friction at the axle. Now, the approach to take in such problems is to treat the block and the disk as two separate systems. So, for the hanging block that we will call system 1, we connect its acceleration to the forces acting on it using Newton's second law. Then we take the disk as system 2 and connect its angular acceleration alpha to the torque acting on it using Newton's second law for rotation. And finally, combine the motion of these two systems, making use of the fact that the linear acceleration A of the block and the tangential linear acceleration AT of the disk rim are the same. So, for system 1, let us identify the forces acting on the block. We can see the force from the cord is T and the gravitational force is mg. So, the equation for Newton's second law would be T minus mg is equal to m into minus a. And here the negative sign indicates that the acceleration is downwards. Now, recall that in most problems, the next step is to write a similar equation along the xx axis. However, here we will consider the rotation of the disk and use Newton's second law in angular form rather than linear. So, we take the axis of rotation perpendicular to the disk and see what form the general equation torque is equal to r times force will take. So, we can see that there are three forces acting on the disk. The gravitational force, the force exerted by the axle, and the tension T from the cord. Notice that these two forces clearly act at the center of the disk. So, we can say that the distance of these forces from the axis of rotation, that is this, is zero, and therefore the torque due to these forces becomes zero going by this equation. Because you see, R is zero here. So, as a simple rule, remember that whenever a force passes through axis of rotation, the torque produced by it is always zero. However, we can see that the third force, that is tension T, acting on the disk due to the cord, acts at a distance R from the axis of rotation and is a tangent to the rim of the disk. That is, it is perpendicular to the position vector r here. So, we can say that the torque due to this force is minus rt. And why minus? Simply because this torque is rotating the disk clockwise and per our sign convention, we should take it as negative. Now, let us assume alpha to be the magnitude of this negative angular acceleration. We also know the rotational inertia I of the disk is half mr square. Then we write this equation as minus rt is equal to half mr square times minus alpha. Remember, the sine of angular acceleration will be the same as the sine of torque, quite the way we say the sine of linear acceleration is the same as the sine of force, which is true because the force and acceleration vectors always point in the same direction. Now, looking at this equation, it seems not so useful since it has two unknowns, that is alpha and t. But then the fact that the cord does not slip, we can say that the magnitude A of the block's linear acceleration should equal the magnitude of tangential linear acceleration of the rim of the disk. And so, in the equation AT is equal to alpha r, we can substitute A for A tangential and get alpha is equal to A upon r. And putting this value of alpha here, what we get is T is equal to half MA. Next, we put this expression for T here to get A is equal to 2M upon M plus 2M times G. And substituting values, we get A is equal to 4.8 meters per second square. Now, we can also find tension T from this equation as T is equal to half into 2.5 into 4.8, which equals 6 newtons. And finally, the angular acceleration of the disk is alpha is equal to A upon R, that equals 4.8 meters per second squared divided by 0.2 meters, that equals 24 radians per second squared. Now, an interesting observation to make is that both A and T depend on the mass of the disk but not on the radius. Also, if we consider this disk as massless, as we usually have been doing in most problems in the past, and put M is equal to 0, we get A is equal to G and T is equal to 0, and this is what we should expect because then the block would just fall as a free body. So, rotational motion with its concepts of angular acceleration and moment of inertia can be a bit tricky to grasp at first. So here is a comprehensive playlist that will guide you step by step through everything you need to know about rotation. Also, if you found this lesson helpful, please give it a thumbs up and I'll see you in the next lesson.